So we had a poll on the channel for the next subject and concepts for faster than light travel and communication, FTL, also called superluminal technologies, got selected. This turned out to be a problem though, because as I began writing up the material, I found I was quickly surpassing even the record holding videos for duration on this channel, terraforming techniques and solutions to the Fermi paradox, both of which were surveys of concepts like this was going to be, and I always felt involved a little too much skimming of the material, and the Lano comes in at nearly an hour long. On the other hand, I've been specifically trying to keep these videos shorter these days, and I just can't imagine giving this subject a proper treatment in anything less than an hour. But a number of the concepts don't require individual treatment, and share a lot of common properties, so we're going to break this up into sections and make a new series, like we have for megastructures and habitable planets. It also means I can turn out videos on subjects in between new installments. As we go through these, we're going to try to give all a fair treatment. Our goal is to familiarize ourselves with these concepts regardless of whether they work, and what we'll see is that some can be outright dismissed, whereas others work, but sometimes only because of possible scenarios require things like negative or imaginary matter that we're not sure even exists. So today we'll look at some of the basics of FTL, the misconceptions about the speed of light a lot of people have, and one of the currently most popular but also misunderstood FTL concepts, quantum entanglement. But before launching into that, I want to emphasize that since I usually try to avoid including anything beyond simple algebra in these videos, and try to keep even that to a minimum, while we can do special relativity with that, we can't do general relativity. The Einstein field equations, the special solutions to which are what open the door for a lot of these ideas, are simply out of our reach. To look at that in any meaningful way, you need the full series of calculus, linear algebra, and both ordinary and partial differential equations. Even with that, proper explanations take a very long while, more than I'm willing to devote in this video or any other. But if you do have that mathematical background and want to get that deeper understanding, I recommend Leonard Susskind's 13-part lecture on general relativity, and the video link will take you to that playlist. But we can talk about special relativity, so let's refresh on that real quick, and we'll see if I can do that in under 3 minutes. Back in the late 1800s, we noticed a peculiar property of light, which is that it always moved at the same speed. Let's illustrate this with Earth. The sun constantly emits a lot of particles, including photons, the particles of light. If we have three people standing on the equator of the Earth measuring these particles, not including the photons, they will get three different speeds because the planet turns. Here at noon, the man is either getting closer or further away from the sun, so he measures the particles at a certain speed, on average about 400 kilometers a second for the solar wind. But the Earth spins around at about half a kilometer a second, so this guy near the dawn is heading right toward the sun at half a kilometer a second, and should measure those particles averaging about 400.5 kilometers a second. His speed combines with their speed. Over here near the twilight, the guy is flying away from the sun, and so the wind particles. They need to catch up to him, and the particle speed measured will be 399.5 km. That's good old-fashioned relativity, Galilean relativity or Galilean invariance. Each of those three people has an inertial frame of reference, which is to say they have a speed and a direction, and each will measure any object's speed and direction differently. Same as you aren't moving when sitting on a bus, but see a guy walking up the aisle of the bus as moving, while someone outside the bus will see you and the guy in the aisle both moving with the addition of the speed of the bus. Back to our Earth model. These guys are measuring the incoming particles at different speeds, but now they start measuring light, incoming photons, and something weird happens. They all measure it at the same speed. Why doesn't matter yet. That was just the state of play at the dawn of the 20th century. Light, for whatever reason, always had the same speed when measured. That's not a consequence of Einstein's special relativity. It's the strange fact he developed the theory to handle. He assumed, postulated, only two things. That the laws of physics were invariant in all inertial frames, which just means the speed and direction you're moving at doesn't change the rules of the universe, and that the speed of light is the same for all observers. It does not vary. It is invariant. Since speed is simply distance over time, 60 miles, a distance, per hour, a time, if people going different speeds are measuring something and getting its speed the same, then Einstein reasoned that these observers had to be measuring different distances and times. And he further reasoned this effect wasn't just limited to light, but to anything traveling fast. The closer the speed of light, the more intense the effect, as governed by this equation. And we've checked this. I don't think there's any theory that's been checked more often and rigorously. So if a guy standing on a giant digital space clock measures that clock as a mile long and checks his watch, he'll see them running at the same speed. If another guy flies by at 87% of the speed of light, he'll see that clock only seems to add a second every other second, and the clock will only be half a mile long to him. Another guy flying by at 97% of light speed will see the clock running at only a quarter as fast as his watch, and will measure the clocks as only being a quarter mile long. Alright, refresher complete, intro complete. I mentioned misconceptions. The first of these is the speed of light itself. It isn't really about light at all. It just happens to be one of the few things that travels at that speed, and the one we first discovered. Any massless particle, such as the gluons that glue quarks together, moves at the speed of light, and nearly massless particles like neutrinos usually move within spitting distance of it. It's even possible photons themselves have a tiny little bit of mass and actually move just a hair under the speed of light. Though, of course, if that were so, we'd have to chuck the speed of light as a term. But that would be fine, since it's more accurate to think of this as the maximum speed information can move at, because that's the actual restraint that matters. Nobody's going to rename it the speed of information, or the maximum propagation rate of cause and effect, but that's more accurate and more appropriate to what we really want to circumvent anyway. We don't really care if the photons get somewhere faster, we care about the signal we are transmitting with those photons. And information in this context includes objects, since a note, or a person, can obviously contain information. The second misconception is that if something is a number of light years away, say 100, you can't get there in under 100 years. That isn't so. You could get there in a second flat if you had enough energy to get really close to the speed of light. When you got there, though, while only a second would have passed for you because of time dilation, their calendar will say it's 100 years in the future. The third misconception is that relativity says nothing can go faster than light. That's never been true or claimed. It's trivially simple to move something faster than light, and the only reason you can't easily verify this yourself is that you need a strong telescope and a very powerful laser to do it. If you stuck a beam on the edge of Mars, and then flicked it as quick as you could across the surface to the other end, someone watching that beam will see it swipe across Mars very quickly and faster than light can travel. In this same way, if you move something in front of a light source, you could get its shadow to move faster than light. That beam and that shadow are things. This is not a quibble, because it's important to a lot of the misreported violations of light speed, nor is it fringe science or radical thinking. This is universally accepted in mundane science. And it matters because while you can argue the dot and the shadow aren't real objects, we have a lot of stuff like virtual particles and wave packets that can do this trick as well, and also have the ethereal status as not exactly real. But what matters is that you couldn't use that to send information faster than light. That light down on Mars will move faster than light, but it won't move when your hand did. It will move when the light generated when your hand moved finally arrives. Same for the shadow. It won't move until the light you're blocking, or no longer blocking, arrives. Stick something right in front of the sun, shadowing Earth, and it won't appear for several minutes. And again, this is an important distinction, because there are other examples of things that move faster than light, or that we have some good cause to think can, and in virtually all of these, we can show how you couldn't use it to transmit meaningful information faster than light. But you've probably seen articles in PopSci publications loudly proclaiming that something does move faster than light, and simply assuming you can use that to send information, when in most cases, they've been outright told by the very person who discovered the item that it does no such thing. We see this a lot with things involving quantum, which leads us to quantum entanglement. Since sometime in the mid-70s to about the turn of the century, the tachyon, which we'll look at next episode, was the go-to particle for science fiction trying to justify their in-story mode of faster-than-light travel. Sometime in the early 2000s, that role got stolen by quantum entanglement. That's actually kind of funny since entanglement has been around as an established idea since the 1930s, but tachyons came up as an idea in the 1960s. Quantum entanglement, leaving out the math, isn't too complex, though the feature that tends to be of interest to people in sci-fi for faster-than-light communication is actually quantum non-locality, what Einstein famously called spooky action at a distance. But quantum entanglement is a situation in which two or more particles are connected in terms of their quantum state. They are entangled. You can't describe individual parts of the system of two or more particles independently and correctly. Distance doesn't appear to matter for this, and the most common entangled state discussed in this would be two particles being created by some event and flying away. So you've got two particles flying away from each other, and being quantum thingies, that whole Schrodinger's cat issue comes into play, where you not only don't know what the properties of that particle are until you measure it, but we're pretty sure it isn't even determined until you do. Now these properties can be anything from spin to charge to momentum, and many others, but for now I'm going to call these koinons, and say that they have the property of being either heads or tails. And when made in pairs, one must be heads and the other tails. What quantum is telling us is that observing a koinon is equivalent to flipping and catching it. Until then, it's spinning around and doesn't have a head state or a tail state. It's both at once. The moment that I catch that, though, the other koinon turns into the opposite. I catch a heads, and a moment later, my lab partner catches the other particle and sees it's on tails. We've checked this tons of times, and as best as we can tell, it's true, and can only happen if those two koinons are talking to each other somehow. And while we haven't determined yet if this is actually instantaneous, we have narrowed this communication down to taking place at no less than 10,000 times the speed of light. This is actually quantum non-locality, which, as the name implies, indicates the ability of quantum things to act in a way which would imply they violate locality, or basically means that they can do things faster than the speed of light, or appear to anyway. The coins, pardon koinons, are entangled. Once one is determined, the other is determined. And it doesn't have to be just one particle. We've done this with larger things like molecules, and hypothetically at least, you could do it with a person. Now obviously your first thought is that you can use this for sending information faster than light, but you can't. Or at least you can't by any method we know. I think people get hung up on the super fast motion and figure that must be able to be tapped. But remember, we already saw that superluminal effects with our Martian laser dot and shadow, and we know you can't send information with either, at least not faster than light, and you can't with quantum entanglement or non-locality either. Here's why not, and we'll just use coins here. I'm giving you a coin and your buddy a coin, a magic pair of entangled coins, and I'm telling you that no matter how far away you are, the moment you flip your coin, his will flip to the opposite side yours comes out on. But this is a truly random coin. You have to flip it. You can't just set it on the side you want. Remember, this is a quantum random event, and it has a 50-50 chance to come up heads or tails. How do you send a message with that? I mean, if we could control the coin, we could easily send a binary code, heads 1, tails 0, too easy. All you're going to generate is random noise though. Heck, quantum randomness like this is one of the few safe ways to generate a truly unbreakable one-time pad encryption, since there will be no pattern to the result. But wait, you can send a message using that coin. I don't need my distant partner to receive heads or tails, I just need him to know I flipped the coin. I decide if I'll flip or not flip the coin once every second. A coin flip, regardless of outcome, and it's a 1. A non-flip is a 0. A simple binary code with a bandwidth of 1 bit per second. Again, too easy. Our digits are simply motion or non-motion. Unfortunately, once again, that doesn't work. Because with quantum particles, you have no way of knowing if your particle has or has not been absorbed when you look at it. It works for a magical coin, but not for entangled particles. I can't send out a constant beam to distant locations from some central location that they can use to transmit information superluminally, or have two big boxes full of entangled particle pairs they can check at need to send messages, because the state of each particle is not determined until you look at it, and you don't actually know if your partner has been looking at it unless someone tells you by old-fashioned light speed. You can both meet up later, or phone each other, and tell each other which one you looked at, and what it was, and note that his was the opposite of yours, but you can't send any information this way. This doesn't necessarily mean we'll never figure out a trick for using this, since these particles appear to be talking faster than light, they presumably use a method that maybe we can use too. But for now, this method is closed off to us, and doesn't appear to have any way we could use it. Next time in the FTL series, we'll take a look at our first exotic matter particle and its role in FTL technologies by looking at tachyons, a hypothetical type of particle that not only goes faster than light, but actually goes backward in time, and we'll discuss the implications and dilemmas of that. If you enjoyed this video, like it and share it. Questions and comments are welcome. And if you want to be alerted when that video comes out, click the subscribe button, and in the meantime, you can try out one of these other playlists. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.